Batbara, a city full of ancestral houses with Spanish architecture that is well preserved to this day. Now, how did it come to be? What is the history of Kabadbaran City?
Disclaimer, this is only a school assignment, so please take it with a grain of salt and research it yourself.
So where did the name come from? There are four possible answers to this. There is babar, which is a type of grass often found in Southeast Asia. Two, que barbaridad, which is a Spanish expression that says, what a barbarity. Third is from kabadbad, antay. And fourth is Badbaran sa Kawadon. The history of Kabadbaran City can be traced back to its early roots. Although we today only have traces of 12th century villages and pre-colonial history in general, some settlements were said to be near the waterways that passed through the territory of the city of Kabadbaran. Aside from what I mentioned earlier, there are no other records found before the Spanish colonization, except for a site in Sanghan where Chinese ceramics from the 15th to 16th century were found. Moving on, in the Spanish era, where the oldest mention of Kabadbaran is from Pueblos de Erección, where it was said to be a small community found on the Bahia or Bay of Butuan, and also mentioned in the cartas or writing of Jesuit priests who encouraged in the communities of Bunawan, Talacogon, and Southern Agusan to settle or form a reduction in a place called Kabarbaran. The union of these communities gave birth to La Reunión de Kabarbaran. However, La Reunión de Kabarbaran did not last long due to challenges such as floods and slow agricultural livelihoods. Eventually, it was revived in 1880 to 1881 by Father Saturnino Orios and was renamed Tolosa, which is now a barangay in Kabadbaran City. But anyway, in 1880, Tolosa was headed by the Teniente del Barrio, Don Eduardo Curato. He petitioned the Spanish authorities for the township application of Tolosa to be approved. On January 31, 1894, the petition was approved. The population and the economy grew, which was driven by agriculture and commerce. But the growth suddenly came to a halt when the revolution against Spain started, and no significant turmoil affected the city after that, until the coming of the American forces in 1901. When the Americans arrived, the Spanish were forced to surrender. Included with them was Captain Andres Atega, also known as Don Andres Atega. Under the Americans, the town was called Kabadbaran, according to Don Andres Atega's proposal. In turn, it brought significant improvements in public education, in terms of public health, and the local economy grew when it started producing abaca from coconut plantations established by the Americans, until World War II. The Japanese occupation. Guerrilla forces resisted the Japanese, engaging in several encounters and battles. If you want to read more of World War II, read this book by Sir Florante A. More. On July 4, 1946, after the liberation, the Philippines was granted independence by America, and the education system expanded. Representative Isauro Gabaldon wrote Act 1801. Which allocated $1 million for the construction of schools throughout the country. One of the Gabaldon buildings we can see in Kabadbaran, in the Kabadbaran Pilot Elementary School, or now we call Kabadbaran South Central Elementary School. Also, infrastructure projects were undertaken. One was the entry of the Manila Mining Corp in the 1960s, the inauguration of the Kabadbaran River Bridge. Fast forward, on July 28, 2007, Kabadbaran was declared a city by the Republic Act 9434. However, it faced legal challenges, but fortunately, on February 15, 2011, it officially regained its city status. Today, Kabadbaran City thrives as a community filled with unity and celebration. Festivals such as Dagkot bring the people together to honor their traditions. Thank you for listening to this small assignment of mine. This was a school project for RPH J2 or Reading in Philippine History by Sir Aramho. I hope you enjoy it. In the Spanish era, which ang akong cellphone lubat na.
Read this book.